Yeah, so welcome from my side in this Contact Cloud Connect. I'm very happy to join. I'm Rolf Sormann. I'm the Business Development Manager for Industrial Analytics and IoT in Weidmüller. Topic today, Industrial Analytics from Data to Value. And I'm going to show you a quite interesting approach about machine learning, easy to use without being a data expert. So let's start directly. Maybe a few of you don't yet know Weidmüller. You may have heard of us, but what are we really doing? We were founded some 170 years ago. What we do, we basically sell anything you need for transmitting power, signal, and data in the industrial environment. In every cabinet, there should be Weidmüller inside. We call it connectivity, automation, digitalization products for the electrical connectivity and automation. Around about 5,000 employees today. Sales last year, 830 million. A global network, sales companies, productions, and around about 30,000 sellable products. So you get an idea in which industry we're present. So we do from the industry for the industry. If we look at our product portfolio, you see that we have very consistently aligned our portfolio along the data mechanics. So from acquiring data in the field, for example, with our I/O system, for local pre-processing with our control unit, communication from gateway to routers and switches, to eventually creating added value through industrial analytics. So coming from there, how do we come to analytics? So we have started around about 5 years ago with some first initial tries in our own company, checking data from our machines in a few factories, trying to evaluate what additional information we can get from the data. And it immediately turned out that was really a benefit that we can see here. And today it is an own business unit. And over the time, after initially addressing a few very specific applications, we find that basically, the industrial application goes across all industries. So you find here representative applications like weldings, injection molding, intralogistics, compressors, pumps, fans, windmills, but also grinding tools, food and beverage applications, 3D printers. So basically, there's very few limits in using analytics in the industrial environment. Of course, there are always some limits, but our experience to 80-90%, we are able to gather the desired use case, a solution that has been discussed and targeted with the customer. What we do see here, from anomaly detection all the way up to predictive quality, this is actually a road to take. Very often, projects are being started with anomaly detection for various reasons, for availability of data, for example, because that's very often a topic for the start of projects, but also because customers have to get familiar with their data and the scope of machine learning. So, anomaly detection is a reasonable and very good starting point. Let's quickly change the level to a very strategic view. I assume you're acquainted with the Gartner Hype Cycle, and we see from the latest edition that AI or machine learning is, of course, still one of the top five major trends. But what we actually see also is that it's not the normal AI or ML, but it is specific fields of the application of AI. That would probably not directly enter industry, but it will go to other parts. But still, also for us, I call it the best is yet to come. There's a lot of homework to do. And actually, I see the next 10 years as the decade to really make the things happen in the industrial environment. What I mean, from the hype to standard, which means a lot of pilot projects, proof of concepts have been executed, but now it has to become a serial product. So a professional solution to be implemented in the machine series, for example. Of course, we keep cost benefit in view always. So from a feature, nice to have, really has to create added value. And I mean, the last years, you're all aware of that. It has been high investments in data, data engineering, hardware, software, labor. Now it's time for really make the return out of this. I anticipate that we're going to need these next 5 or 10 years to make this happen. But the focus shall clearly be on a few key topics, specifically on machine learning. It should be a driver for innovation. So really enhance the product capabilities, optimize processes. A very practical, I call it low-hanging fruit, a bit challenging, but prediction on board, I think, is a use case that's completely accepted. So on each relevant machine, prediction function needs to be on board. So we have to make this happen with a low-effort approach, and for that, we need suitable toolboxes. Of course, there's plenty of other things, but as we're talking today about industrial analytics, these are some few things to focus on. The challenge today is that we have quite a big range of machine experts, core knowledge about mechanical, electrical automation since decades, strong topic, strength of the industries, but there are no data scientists. This pretty new field is dedicated to a new generation of people. They're growing, but very often, of course, they don't have that manufacturing background. So how do we bring these two topics together? A brief view on the data mechanics. Always we have to go from data to models. And alongside, we have to go through the so-called machine learning pipeline. And in order to do that today, you need expertise in data. So these 20, 25 major steps that you have to go through, you need to be an expert. So a regular domain expert will not be able to go through this path. So what's the challenge? This new approach that we need is to enable the domain experts to do machine learning themselves. One, the expertise is available, yeah, and we need the domain expertise in order to understand the machine and to apply machine learning in the right way. The machine learning knowledge is, of course, necessary to create good models, but maybe doesn't have to be a machine learning expert in person, but has knowledge about how to create machine learning models. So a few data scientists, growing community, of course, but they're not enough in the next 10 years for the needs of the industry, or they have different tasks in the company. So for example, more strategic roles, selecting the right tools, driving the networking or the networking of different locations, consulting or leading the team of operational data experts or domain experts who use tools. So they have in the future, I think, very different and more important roles than just making machine learning models. So the key to success is here really to give domain experts who have the knowledge the right machine learning tools. If we fit these two things together, we get this new economic approach. In other words, to come from data set to model results, you don't have to go through all these kind of complicated expertise topics, but use your domain knowledge and a smart tool. You may ask, Why is this machine? What is this machine learning automation? It's actually, of course, not automating algorithms further. We're using available algorithms from the community of hundreds of thousands of experts. What we're doing is we're automating the machine learning pipeline. So the tasks of data pre-processing, of feature engineering, of model training, this is automated specifically for time series data in industrial applications. So in order to come from input data to result data from the models that we can then use in the operational machining. Input tasks, I will show that now. So the user does give his knowledge inside, and the automation tasks, machine learning, have been worked in the background. So it sounds a bit theoretical. Let's go to the practical example. It's an end-to-end solution. So input data to model and model to execution. We're going to look at the model builder. So here on the left side, this is the model builder, a cloud-based service that is working with historic data. Yeah, so you take data from the field, from a couple of days, a month, 10,000 cycles, whatever is a representative data set, and you go through guided steps here. In order to create models that you then evaluate, and finally store the best model. In the runtime, the model will be executed on the machine level. So you take the best model, you deploy it in a container, you bundle it with the data storage for input data, for output data, for scheduling. So how often should I run this model, with which input data, on which machine? You configure the asset next to it. So this is being composed in a container with a web interface and can be executed on the machine or in the cloud also. Right, so let's take a look at the model builder. Very practical four steps. First thing is to get familiar with the data. You upload the data, the historic data that you've gathered from the field, and you get a dashboarding here, and you familiarize yourself with the individual data lines. Example, you have here numerical values of temperature of motor 2, for example, and you get firsthand, it's a little bit small maybe to see, missing values, zeros, constant values. So on the top level, you get firsthand information about the data quality and if there's a lot of missing values. Of course, you can go more in detail, see the statistical distribution, see the plots, see some statistics behind min-max medians. So you can evaluate, is the missing value relevant? Was there some issues with data acquisition? Is a high rate of constant values normal because it's just a state, or is the critical topic? So familiarize with the data, make a quality check, and if necessary, go back and update the data that you need. The second step is so-called feature engineering. Machine learning models will not be working with raw data. They'll be working with features of the raw data. Simple example, again, the temperature. So an absolute temperature of a motor is not directly going into a machine learning model. You can imagine, of course, it can be in a hot environment, a cold environment. So what will enter into machine learning models are features of the temperatures. For example, you compare actual temperature to target temperature. You compare the deviation of temperature over time. You compare the mean of temperature for a smoothening, so get the jitter out of data. Second derivation, comparing quotients, whatever, with the knowledge, the expert knowledge of the machine, you do create manually some features here. And this is an important step that the expert gives his knowledge into the tool. Later on in the automation, automation of machine learning, we also generate features additionally to the manually generated features here. So expert has the chance to bring directly his knowledge in here, simple to use, no code approach. And the last step already is what we call data annotation. So we enrich the data by actually marking specific time ranges. Anticipate this is the curve of temperatures of two motors. You see here some rise in temperature, very obvious anomalies here for a good visualization of this example. And the user marks this time range here as a normal behavior. So the tool later on learns that in this time range, all the data lines that we get show a normal behavior. But by default, the normal behavior is marked green. And you can also mark anomal behavior, by default red, so that the model later for training gets also anomal behavior. You can also mark other categories of mistakes, errors, which leads to a classification model. So if you know the behavior of the machine and you know that this error relates to a certain type of error, then you can give this classification as a category into the tool. So this you do only for a representative part of the data. Of course, you don't have to mark all areas, but a handful of relevant time ranges you mark as normal, anormal, or specific classifications of data. Right, and that's already it. You start the model training, and a couple of minutes later, you get the results. So models are being trained, the best models are being displayed here, and you get some meta information, for example, what type of algorithms are being used, what quality level does the model have, and we try to make it here in a readable format, so we don't use data science terms too much, like an F1 score, but we give a percentage of anomalies being identified, for example. So you see here feature importance, and on the bottom part, you get the visualization, the plot of the model behavior. So you choose a model, you relate it to certain data lines, and you see the reaction of the model. It's actually cut here a little bit, but you get a visualization of each individual model related to each individual data format or feature. And eventually you load the best model and you export it for execution on the machine level. All right, which leads us, and that's already the little tour that I wanted to do with you. It leads us to this page. Model creation has been done here, and the second part is then the model execution on the machine. It can be on-premise, but it can also be in the cloud, depending really on the architecture and the concept that's available in the customer, in the company. Right, and finally, one last outlook that I would like to give is the idea of integrating this automated machine learning as a digital service into industry platforms. You see here the example of Elements for IoT from Contact Software. Anticipate any industry portal platform, custom specific platform, or industry platforms. And the target is, of course, to seamlessly integrate such services into the platforms. The word seamless, of course, our task. So we need to have it easily integratable. So open interfaces, standard protocols being used, so that you as a user can really access a platform and choose I want to have the AutoML service integrated here. It's platform independent. It's independent from the automation typology, what PLC environment you're on. There's no dependency here. And we can even think that if you're simulating data, for example, in the prototyping environment, then you can also add the AutoML service as one vertical service to your platform. Right, so that's my short tour on machine learning easy to use. The key takeaways, we understand that we need an industrial application to this new approach. The domain expert will play a central role here. His knowledge is key and is the main part that we need. In order to make him, to give him the tools on hand, there needs to be good, easy to understand, intuitive tools available. We've looked at one of those tools. And also for further automation, we can have this tool as a service integrated into existing platforms. For example, AutoML is also available in the Azure Marketplace. So target is to have such services integrated easily into the existing platforms and custom specific systems. All right, I think time is up. Thank you very much for your attendance. Hope to see you soon again. And I wish a good continuation in the Cloud Connect conference. Thank you very much.